today we're going to once again go over FIONA, and in particular we'll talk about how to get enough signal, getting the labels right enough and having them. Closer. You guys can come up. Okay. So, how to get enough signal. At first, we'll again go over FIONA just like we did last time, so hopefully much faster. And so, basically, hopefully you all know this, that you can determine the position of a single molecule. The single molecule has a width, which is goes like lambda over 2, lambda being the wavelength of the emitted light, like 500 or 600 nanometers, divided by 2 gives you 250 to 300 nanometers. But in fact, we can determine the center very accurately if we know, in fact, that it's a single molecule. And the precision of which we can determine where the center is goes like the width divided by the square root of n. That's 250 divided by square root of n. With, if you have 10,000 photons, this ends up being 250 over the square root of 10,000, which is 2.5 nanometers, and then it turns out you actually get that effect of 2 better. Okay? So that's.
What's SN short for?
Excuse me?
SN with.
Oh.
Or SN with SN?
SN is signal to noise, which is basically the square root of N. Actually, as we'll see in a little bit, it's actually not the square root of n, because if you have a lot of detector noise, that will add an effective n being larger. Also, if you look at it with a camera that has a really big pixel width, then in fact you can't determine where this is to better than the pixel or so. And we went through that, but here we're interested in taking a molecular motor and attaching the fluorophore to your foot down here, and we're interested in knowing whether the molecular motor moved like an inchworm or hand over hand, or it moved in a walking type of motion. In this case, if we take like kinesin, which walks like 8.3, 8.4 nanometers per ATP, then if it goes in an inchworm fashion, everything is just a translation. So everything, both my cargo and my feet, will move with like 8.3 nanometers. However, if you're walking, so if you're moving 8.3 nanometers with a cargo, the back foot moves twice that, which is 16.6 nanometers. And then it moves 0, and then 16.6, and then 0. So we should be able to tell the difference. And this is what we have. And in fact, you can see, this is just a blow up of this, it's walking with very close to 16.6 nanometers. In fact, in this case, the average distance that the fluorophore is walking is 16.3 nanometers. Therefore, it must move 16.3 nanometers and zero, and then 16.3. Because only one of the heads is labeled with a fluorophore. If two heads, if they were labeled with different fluorophores, you'd see, let's say, the blue, and then the red, and then the blue. All of them would be alternating 16.3. But in this case, and what we spent a fair amount of time last time, is actually we can determine the zero nanometer step. And who remembers how we determined that?
The fact that there are zero counts for zero dwell time, as opposed to just a decaying exponential.
Okay. And first, what is a dwell time?
How long it stays still.
Good. Okay. So this would be a dwell time of, let's say, you know, a third of a second. This would be a dwell time of, you know, very little. This little, this is a fair amount. And this, and each one is, you're putting a graph. Okay. So can you have the dwell time and then the number of them? So say it again.
So because you have zero counts of zero dwell time,
this is going down like
crazy. Right, it's going down to zero.
Okay.
So that essentially says that it's impossible to have constant motion with no dwell time. And because of that, it can't be in an inchworm fashion, which would permit that kind of motion.
That's right. So basically, there's always a delay in the step. 16.6, and then it has to be a little delay while this takes it, and then you can do it again. And under the assumption that you assume that the both stepping is actually the same, it will actually go to zero. Yeah.
And why wouldn't the inchworm? Why would the inchworm have to have a?
Why would it?
What's the difference? Like, why wouldn't the inchworm just go once?
Okay. We're detecting a hidden step. That is, it's hidden. Is that it's not giving us any signal. That is. So it's 16.6. Yes. You imagine that you just have 1 foot length. So you get 16.6, okay? And now you want to find out, you want to record. Takes a step, and then you record how long it's going to be. Well, you know that this guy must go, and then it will go. This guy will go, and then it will go. So there's always this hidden step in there, and you will basically record that. And the way, if you record it and then plot it, basically you'll never get that it will manage to go and then, you know, go again.
But wouldn't you be able to say that it's an inchworm waiting for the ATP to volunteer?
Okay, so imagine that it's an inchworm, okay? So it's waiting for ATP. So and then it goes. Now it's waiting for some ATP, and it goes. Is there any hidden step involved in this? There's certainly a step that you actually measure, that is, it will be the average ATP. And as, same thing with this, what happens when the ATP is low, for example? What would this actually show? What will the dwell time be?
More to the right.
Right. It'll be more. It'll sort of go up more slowly and then like that. So in this case, what will be? Will there be any fall off here? Yes?
I think so, yes.
Everybody agree? Disagree?
Well, what's the fall? Do you mean intercepts the x-axis at zero?
Yes. What? Why will it go be zero here?
There's still a dwell time.
There's still dwell time. It may take a while, da da da, da and then goes, da, da 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 da, and then goes. But there's still that dwell time. So that's in this case. In the inchworm fashion, it's sort of, there's some dwell time, but there is no hidden step. So what you'll get in this case, what you'll get is an exponential. There is no hidden step. Now the lifetime of the exponential, that of course will be a function of ATP. And the lower the ATP, the in general the slower the fall time is.
But if it's an exponential, you're saying that there's a higher count for dwell time of zero.
That's right.
But wouldn't it still need to wait for the ATP to run to?
Yes. But this is, remember, the dwell time, the time it is just waiting for an ATP.
The mean for exponential.
What's that?
The mean for exponential distribution is not zero. That's it.
Right. The mean is definitely not. But the zero time point for an exponential, of course, is always the biggest. Yeah.
So this may not be the idea, but if the chimism had three legs instead of two, and somehow it kept moving sequentially, would the math get a lot more complicated, or would it be
if you want to say that, let's say all three legs, so I guess you'd have two hidden steps.
Yes.
And the you actually, there are definitely examples of this. Does the math get a lot more difficult?
Oh, like the
no, what ends up happening is you have a t to the nth, where if n equals 1, then it's 2 feet. If n equals 3, then it's the number of feet is 3. The t to the is then t squared. T to the number of steps minus 1. It turns out that's all it is.
Like for the ATPs.
Yes, in fact. Exactly. That is exactly, that's right. So you must have taken biophysics 401.
That's right.
So was the crystal structure known for this before, or is this?
For kinesin?
Yeah.
Before what?
before this study?
Well, we actually published it in ...2004.
Mm-hmm.
So was there a crystal structure? Yes.
Okay.
The crystal structure of the kinesin. There has never been a crystal structure of the kinesin on a microtubule.
I see.
Yeah. Ever of that. Though it's interesting, they're now starting to get atomic resolution with cryo-EM. Interesting, but that's enough. Okay, and now we wanted that the signal to noise is actually goes as S squared over N. So, but then there's this other case that you have pixel size. That is, in this case, this is a pixel size of 100 nanometers, and so this is drawn in false color. So white is the biggest counts, then orange, then green, and so forth. And what was pointed out last time is, you know, this is fitted, it's not fitted, but if you count the number of photons here, and then here, and then here, you get a Gaussian over here. And the same thing, you get a Gaussian here. So you might have a pixel size of 100 nanometers, but you can see it move even a very small amount. You know, you can see it move 8.4 nanometers. And you guys, if you haven't done it already, you will get it. The reason you can see 8.4 nanometers is because you can see a slight shift in this because there's quite a number of pixels, maybe 8 here and 8 here. And so by fitting to all of those pixels, you can actually get the 8 nanometers.
Yes, so I have a problem with this.
Okay.
Because the fluorophore could be rotating.
Ah, yes. Yes, it could be rotating. In which?
And then, I guess it depends on the size of the fluorophore. The rotation may be larger than that.
Yes. In fact, you're right. The fluorophore may be a huge thing, and it may be diffusing around. And in that case, you know, if it's here, and you know, it's big guy like this, and then here, and then, you know, big guy like this, and then here, and big guy like this. That's right. That was, in fact, my feeling about what would happen. And this wouldn't work. Turns out, that wasn't a big problem. Why not? Was it not diffusing anymore?
Still was, but it was smaller than what you can see.
Is that right? I don't know. Could it, you know, let's say, whoa, you know. Yes?
Could it be that on average it didn't, it was like they'd go either way so that when you took
Exactly. Exactly. It was averaged out over the time scale of which I took a measure. And it turns out diffusion is incredibly fast. Assuming that you weren't biased in some ways, and it turns out it's not really a problem. It turns out that you mentioned some other fact, that there's polarization involved in this, that the light is actually polarized. And we've actually done studies on this. And it turns out that if the fluorophore is polarized, what actually happens is you will not see a Gaussian profile. And everything is different. It turns out you can, if you're careful, somewhat account for it, but basically you lose your resolution. So in fact, one very important thing that you have to do is you have to go and look at the polarization and make sure that in fact the polarization is zero. Okay, so we have the effect of pixel size, but it turns out if you actually do the numbers, if the pixel size is less than 90 nanometers, it's really small. It's very small. So you basically just set it to 90 nanometers or so, and then you don't worry about it.
What is
the number of photons?
And the total number?
The total number of photons.
So what is SI?
SI is the width or the is the standard deviation, in fact. And N is the total number of photons. And notice that so your uncertainty is equal to S squared, S squared over N. Well, this, so that the S is essentially the width. So that this width squared square root is just like the width over the square root of N. That's exactly. The width divided by the square root of N.
So SI is a standard deviation for a single, like a single measurement, and you
multiply. Yep. And A is, you're collecting this with a certain pixel size. This pixel size we're talking about is A, but let's say it's 100 nanometers. Wait, that seems a little funny. It's 100 nanometers?
It's A squared.
A is the pixel width, and I'm saying it's like if you get it to 100 nanometers, you'll be taking the photons here enough that it goes just fine. What determines what this is? You imagine you have some photon and it's in your microscope, and then you have some detector. So go ahead, think about it and tell me where this 100 nanometers comes from. And go ahead, you try to do it. You can imagine the camera is some size. The pixel size is not the diameter
size. The peak,
right?
And then you can just say, okay, well, this is going to, like, you can just take a ruler and say, okay, what's the average? This is one line, this is one line, this is another line, this is the fourth line.
I think the nice is a function of
imagining. You look at a picture of
you know, the
square is just individual pixels.
Yeah, I need to know that you're probably not getting one of the sensor. The sensor is not going to represent the
I'm hearing a lot of the right sounds. Somebody is talking about pixel size. You have to know the magnification. So, good. You're doing what? Well, so what's the answer? Or who cares? How does the magnification come into it? And how does the pixel size come into it? What's happening?
Oh, I think I kind of got what you're saying. The pixels, the size of the image. So this is primarily a function of your camera, and not your computer screen where you're actually pixels. The pixel width is just the representation of how much distance, like the efficacy of your camera's resolution.
Okay. And how do you get a little bit more quantitative? Can everyone see this? Why don't you turn on the light for a minute? So this is your fluorophore, right here, and it's going to get imaged onto here. This here is the CCD. If this is just a single one, a tiny point, you know, one nanometer, how big is this? after it gets imaged. Wavelength over 2. So in fact, if it's a bit smeared out, right? And that's okay. So tell me about the pixel size and the magnification. Where, how does that come into it? Don't be quiet. Let's say you have this 250 nanometer object and you're have a camera that, you know, is looking like that. How well can you determine that? Right, the whole idea is to determine where the center is. But you've collected it all on, you know, one pixel. So you can't tell if it's here, or if it's here, or anywhere, right? But okay, so that's the ridiculous thing of you're capturing it all on just one point. So let's capture it like that. Which is, you know, 1, 2, 3, and so forth. Now you have eight images across. So here you get 1, 2, 3, 4, so forth. So it definitely depends on the pixel size. Now, what is the, but it doesn't just depend on the pixel size, because of the size of this with respect to the pixel size. Well, okay, we figured out we have to make sure and, you know, get the pixel size small enough. But the size of this compared to this, what will it actually be? Does it have to do with the magnification? Some guys go no, and some guys go yes. Let's say that this guy
does, because we want the object to be larger, so it goes into more pixels.
Ah, okay. So it does depend on the magnification, or so you think.
Yeah, so for a higher magnification, the amplitude of your Gaussian will decrease if you fix the number of pixels collected.
But
yeah,
it's relative, so it's okay.
Yeah. I think it's fine.
that's right. This is some magnification M, you know, for example, it's, you know, 100 times. And so the CCD, that it comes from the manufacturer. And it's commonly 16 microns. Sometimes it's 8, sometimes it's 24, or so forth. But the pixel size is usually, you know, on the order of 16 microns. Of course, it has like 512, 16 microns over here. So you, all you do is take 16 microns divided by, in this case, 100. So then that's equivalent to like 160 nanometers in terms of, you know, right there. So in this case, you would get, it was here, and then you'd get another at 160, and then at 320. And it turns out that, as I mentioned, about 90 nanometers instead of 160 nanometers is better. Because here you can see if this is a width of 250 nanometers, you know, you don't get really many points here. Where if you 90 nanometers, it is actually enough. Some of your looks of days.
And you can only buy 100 bits? Is that the maximum you can buy now?
This?
Yeah.
No, actually, what we commonly do is we have a 100x objective, and then you actually add another lens here, which in fact commonly is 1.6 times magnification, so the total is 160. And so then the 160 magnification with 16 microns is 100 nanometers. And that's like perfect.
Why not just keep increasing?
Why not keep increasing? That's a very good question. Why not?
Maybe it's computational powers or like large data that are not necessary.
Yes.
There's the third term, right? The e squared and the denominator?
Yeah.
So if you made a even smaller, that term would increase.
If you have some background. But let's assume that you don't have background. We'll come back to it. You're correct. But B is if you have some background. But let's forget about it. Let's assume that camera, in fact, has zero background. You've already A squared. The amount of so-called noise that you're adding is inconsequential at some point. And so, yeah, you could multiply by another factor of 2 or another factor of 4, but yeah, what's the point? The point is that it with a given value of n, you know, this is going to be, this term is going to be, you know, like a few percent of this. And so, okay, who cares if it's 2% or 1%, that sort of thing. It turns out that there actually is another reason. If you slice it up too much, then you're more sensitive to actually the polarization. And so you don't want
but
that.
Would it be better to take into account polarization but still get a more accurate?
It's essentially impossible to, or very difficult. The other thing is actually the background. This basically is what costs you like $40,000 when you want to do this kind of experiment, because the background must be very low. Because in general, you know, if you have more background, you know, you get a signal, but on top of this constant background, and the background kills you. And so it's important that doesn't kill you, that this term is much less, well, certainly than the photon noise. And that is what costs you $40,000.
So is that like per experiment or?
No. It cost you $40,000 for the CCD.
Okay.
Just like, you know, your iPhone or whatever, you know, the cost of a CCD is, I don't know, probably $5 or something like that. Mm-hmm. That's because, in general, when you take a picture, you know, you have plenty of light hitting it, and the amount of noise that comes from your CCD is not significant. When you're looking at a single molecule, there isn't a lot of extra light or extra signal. Okay. So basically, what is going on? You now know sort of all of the in terms of you basically go to a small enough pixel size that doesn't matter. You go to small enough background, spend a lot of money, that doesn't matter. And the whole thing then comes down to the width divided by the square root of n, which is what we had initially. Okay. What properties of dyes do you need for FIONA, that is, to get super accuracy localization? You should light off that. What properties of the dye?
Would you be able to use, like, ultraviolet, fluorescent,
and what? And to do what?
To localize the thing much more precisely.
And why is that? Why do you want to use ultraviolet light?
It's short.
Yes. And the answer is yes. You should go to shorter and shorter wavelengths to get the width of that calcium smaller. But you can make the adjustment that the pixel size would be negligible. But there's a limit in that, A, there are not good fluorophores that exist in the UV. The other thing is the UV is very damaging to your sample. And so you don't want to use UV for that reason. So you're basically constrained to use the visible. In fact, even within the visible, you know, there's blue, green, red. There is still much more autofluorescence, that's what it's called, when you excite things down at 400 nanometers than when you're at 700 nanometers. So, okay. What property of dyes do you need for FIONA? Okay, super accuracy resolution. What's the important parameter? Yeah. Yeah, that's right, it's the wavelength, but you're basically stuck in the visible. Yeah?
It shouldn't bleach too fast.
Aha! Yes, it shouldn't bleach too fast. Why is that?
You need long images.
Yeah, that's right, it's photostability. Okay, so let's give an example of this. You guys are looking not in cells, in vitro. But you often want to look in a cell. And in fact, we've done it. And here you can see that it's walking with actually both dynein and kinesin. What we had to do is we had to get the label in there, and it had to be bright enough. The question is, with cells, how do you get it in there? It turns out, by and large, you cannot use the regular dyes that you do for in vitro stuff. What do you use?
Quantum dots.
Quantum dots. Quantum dots are like an external fluorophore. In fact, quantum dots are even worse in that the quantum dots, for those of you who don't know, quantum dots are little dots, but they're typically 10 or 20 nanometers across. They're actually very big. Most fluorophores are just a couple of nanometers. So they're even tougher on the cell. Yes, yes. You want fluorescent proteins. And in fact, in this particular example, we used GFP. Who knows what GFP is? No. Okay, so for those of you who know what GFP is, why don't you explain it? GFP stands for green fluorescent protein, and it is, yes?
It's a protein that's pretty easy to attach to a lot of like biological things. You can put it in a living thing's genome, such as the monkey over there, and it will literally fluoresce. Therefore, it will fluoresce. It will be green in a dark room.
Okay, that's correct. And you can put it in an amazing number of things. Originally, it was in jellyfish. So, have any of you seen this? At night, you look at it in the ocean and you see little jellyfish. And they're, well, they can be like green. Who's seen this? Just two. Where did you see it?
Yeah, it's in
the
ocean
in
China.
In China, okay. And where did you see it?
In my city, in Poland.
Ah, okay. You can see it also in the United States, but yeah, it's really, really cool. So these are proteins that happen to also fluoresce. Typically, it fluoresces in the green, therefore it's called green fluorescent protein. What is, yes?
So, is it the sequence of amino acids in the green fluorescent proteins, like tryptophan, there's a lot of them, that's why.
That's right, we can actually, we won't have time today as usual, but yes, indeed, if GFP has a molecular weight of like 25,000. And does anybody know with an amino, like how many amino acids is that?
Divided by 0.1. So one amino acid is like
0.1 kD. So 100 Daltons. That's right. So how much is a protein that weighs?
250.
So yes, exactly. So GFP has about 250 amino acids. And what's amazing about it is you can actually isolate it. Then they isolate it from jellyfish, and through the powers of molecular biology, as he said, you can attach it to anything that you want. And this happens to be kinesin, which we've talked about.
You don't attach the protein, you attach the DNA.
No, actually, well, yes and no. Eventually, you're attaching the protein over here to the other protein. What's amazing about it is you actually feed the cell the GFP, the DNA for the GFP, and it takes it in this amazing fashion. It gets attached to wherever you want it. And the cell is completely fine. And that is what is amazing about it, is you can it's called transform a cell to make it, so at first it has no GFP, then it has GFP, and it's completely fine, and it's perfect specificity. That is, the GFP is labeled just to kinesin, or just to myosin, or just to a ribosome, or whatever. It's really amazing. And in fact, they've now made lots of different fluorescent protein mutants. There's banana, there's apple, there's red, there's plum. That's what they happen to be called. Okay. And in fact, the three people won a Nobel Prize for this. Okay, so that's in fact what we did. One problem with this, so why not always use GFP? The answer is it's not very photostable. It puts out about 50,000 counts before photobleaching. So you're sort of screwed again. So how did we do it? If one gives you a few photons and then photobleaches, how do we get, you know, this right here, in fact, is about 4,000 photons actually in about a millisecond, 2 milliseconds. Yes?
You figure out how long it takes for the green fluorescent protein to photobleach and then make the camera exposure just exactly that long.
Yeah, okay, you do that, but 50,000 photons, let's say if you want to get, we got 4,000 photons, it turns out, right there, and therefore we got like 1.5 nanometer accuracy. So 4,000 photons, and it's going to last for 50,000, so that basically gives you 12 images. Right? Okay, so this is 4,000 photons in about 2 milliseconds. So 12 images would be 12 times 2, 24 milliseconds. So that's how long you can look for. 24 milliseconds. And then the thing is,
how much dwell time?
In this case, it happens to be 2 milliseconds. It's very fast.
So and in that 2 milliseconds, the tip typically lasts 1 second, right?
Yes. It turns out it doesn't just walk. In this case, inside of a cell, there's a lot of ATP. So actually, what it's really doing is it's running. And you want to take an image really fast such that you catch it while it's going. But there's still the question of how are you going to use this GFP? You know, yes, you could use it that it's giving out 50,000 photons and you're going to look at it for all of 12 frames. It's kind of crappy. You know, if you want to get into Science magazine as this one did, you can't have that. So how do you do it?
Do bursts of light?
Look, if one gives you $50,000, use more. You get it bright enough. You use many GFPs.
If you're using many of them, would it be the same as using a quantum dot?
The problem is, the quantum dot, in order to get that inside the cell, basically have to tear apart the membrane and get it in.
Yeah.
So it's not the same. Because you put it in, via DNA, which the DNA can go in. Okay? Yes?
So when you see many GFPs, so you've used more than one GFP to
Yes. Essentially, what we've done is we've taken what's called a peroxisome. Is it an organelle in the cell? And we've labeled it with a little zip code. And the zip code, which is attached to the GFP, directs the GFP to come in and bind in the membrane of the peroxisome. And in fact, it does it many times. And so you're looking at the peroxisome moving now not with one GFP, but with a couple hundred GFPs. And that's why you get it so bright.
Do they all turn on at the same time, or they turn on randomly by sequential?
They essentially turn on randomly, but they're not sequential.
Okay.
Well, all that counts with FIONA is that you have a photostable fluorophore. You do not need, in this case, with FIONA, you did not need to have a fluorophore that turns on and turns off. You don't. You just need a fluorophore that's giving you enough photons in the period of time that you want to look.
Then the points per function is basically changing all the time, right?
Good. Good question. Is the point spread function changing all the time? How big is the peroxisome? Yeah, in fact, in general, let's say it's below 250 nanometers. So in fact, if you go and image this, this actually looks like one super GFP. Okay, so we don't seem to have a problem here. But we've done that. We've pushed this limit. Let's say the peroxisome, you know, was on the order of 1 micron. How is this going to work? Is this going to screw you over for FIONA or not? So you have something that's 1 micron. What is it going to, on your CCD, what is it going to form, this diffraction limited spot, or is it going to form something wider?
And you'll be able to see the peroxisome by itself.
Yeah, you're imaging with one peroxisome.
Yeah.
Okay. But what does the image look like? I mean, if it consists of one GFP, it looks like 250 nanometers. And if it consists of many GFPs that are tight together, it still looks like 250 nanometers. But now, what if it consists of many GFPs but that are spread out?
Why does it still look like 250 nanometers if there are many?
Well, they are if they're within 250 nanometers.
But if it's 1 micrometer?
Ah, then it's good. Then it's different.
Splits.
Then what does it look like?
Some white signal with many densities.
Yeah?
Overlapping.
Yeah, that's right. They'll be overlapping, but you know, it looks like this. The width, it will essentially be like 1 micron. Can you do Fiona on this?
If we have small enough pixels, then maybe.
Yeah, it turns out you can do it no problem. As long as the GFPs are not redistributing as it's going. So basically, if you have a whole thing, let's say 1 micron, and it's emitting, and then you know, it's going and moving over here. In general, you know, it'll go over here, and you can again tell the center, and then tell the center again.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, Fiona works just perfectly.
How come it's not redistributing? How come it's not redistributing? Doesn't the memory has fluidity, or is too dense that you can't even tell if it's fluid?
Either it's not, or it is distributing and it's much faster. Either one is actually okay. Which it is, we don't actually know, but in some senses, we don't care.
Mm-hmm. Is it like an active peroxisome, or just clean peroxisome?
No, it's active.